what do you see? Amount of waste? A pile of grayish rock? Let me tell you what I see. A heap of opportunity. It is clear, if we want to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees, as called for in the Paris Agreement, we need to reduce emissions drastically. Even with far-reaching emission reduction measures, some emissions will remain. These so-called residual emissions we need to address with carbon dioxide removal from the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide removal includes capturing and storing CO2. We differentiate natural and technological storage. The biggest natural carbon sink that we know of is the ocean, followed by forests and soil. But also geological formations are a place where we can store carbon, for instance, in rocks or the underground. Technological solutions, on the other hand, are human-made carbon sinks. Combining what's naturally possible with technology to increase the impact is the approach we have been pursuing. As there is a material which, when left outside for thousands of years, actually stores carbon from the atmosphere. Now, I hope you agree that this is painfully long. So, we saw the need to accelerate this process technologically. The material I'm talking about is all around us. It's the world's largest waste stream. It's below our feet, and literally today above our heads. It's concrete. Concrete consists mainly of three things: sand and gravel, water, and cement. The production of cement, shown in its simplified form up on screen, is responsible for a major amount of global greenhouse gas emissions at around 8%. The world's largest waste stream is concrete demolition waste, and it is estimated at around 5 billion tons per year globally. 5 billion tons. A small car weighs around a ton. 5 billion cars are actually triple the amount of cars that are licensed on this whole planet, just to give you an idea of how much that is. So, how do we store carbon dioxide in concrete demolition waste? Well, we capture CO2 at point source at a biogas plant. And this is CO2 which would have otherwise been emitted into the atmosphere. We then liquefy and transport the CO2 to a storage plant nearby. And this is where the concrete demolition waste comes into play. The storage site is located at a concrete recycler's place. A concrete recycler takes demolition waste, crushes and screens it before selling it off into the market again as material to build roads, fundaments, or even structural parts in buildings. As a mineral resources engineer, I've always loved the trash-to-treasure approach, and this is certainly one of them. So, carbon storage is actually an add-on to the concrete recycler's normal processes. After the material has been crushed and screened into small particles, the small particles are placed in a reaction chamber. And in the reaction chamber, CO2 is injected in a gaseous state. Back behind me, and I apologize, you can't read it as well, from left to right, you see a CO2 tank, an evaporator where the CO2 changes state from liquid to gases, the control unit, which steers the entire process, and the reaction chamber I've just been talking about. Now, the reaction chamber is actually where the magic happens. After 2 to 3 hours, the CO2 has reacted with the remaining cement in the material. Chemically, it's actually the reverse reaction to the calcination process that we have seen in the beginning of this talk. So, the CO2 solidifies in contact with the particles, literally fossilizes to limestone. You cannot see or sense that change, but if you look under a microscope, you can tell that the surface of the particles has slightly changed. Now, the reaction has been known for a very long time. What is new is accelerating that process from thousands of years down to 2 hours, and also the exact quantification of the amount of CO2 stored in the material. That is done via flow meters and several sensors in the reaction chamber. It is important because that little tweak enables us to sell carbon certificates into the market and reward the recyclers for every ton of CO2 stored. What this plant can do in 1 hour is what 50 fir trees can do in a year. Even if we take the material and build roads out of it again, we do not only save primary material, but we also store the CO2 permanently. And this reaction can only be reversed if we heat the material over 600 degrees or we bathe it in acid, which is both quite improbable to happen. Unlike if we cut down the fir tree, which releases the CO2 back into the atmosphere upon degradation. With this technology developed and 5 billion tons of concrete demolition waste in the market, we see the potential to store 50 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. Now, while this might seem like a whole lot, it is actually only around 3% of the CO2 emitted by the cement production process per year globally. So, will this technology solve the climate crisis? No. But it is an important puzzle piece on our way to decarbonize the construction industry, alongside measures like reducing and substituting cement, adjusting concrete recipes, and what Magda talked about earlier, adjusting the way we build. What's more important is that it's actually something that we can do today. There is no one solution to solve the global challenges that we are currently facing. But if we do work together, it is in our hands to solve it. Now, look at that pile again. What do you see? Thank you.